I invite you to please stand. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, and to remember before God our brother Ted, to give thanks for his life, and to commend him to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in grief. We invite you immediately following the service to join us in the fellowship hall for a time of meal and a chance to share memories of Ted. After a little bit of time, we'll be heading to Hay River Lutheran Cemetery to lay Ted to rest. You are invited to join us there as well. We begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our first hymn, In the Garden, which is printed on the back of your bulletin. We sing In the Garden, which again is printed on the back of your bulletin.
Thank you.
O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Ted. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we'll have our sharing of memories. And Ted's son, Brad, will be sharing for the family.
First of all, please understand I'm going to do the best I can. I'm full of emotion, and if I lose it, I'm just going to sit down. And you can go home and tell everybody how great a job I did. And we'll just go from there. I've been saying, I'm a lucky man. I was raised by Ted. But there are things about Ted that people don't know that I wanted to pass on. I talked to my siblings and we okayed what I could say and what I couldn't say. But my dad might have been the kindest person I've ever known. But he's still, where that came from, I'm not sure. Maybe through his Jesus, I don't know. He lived a tough childhood. He wouldn't want me to explain it all, but it wasn't easy. By 11 years old, he was stricken with two different types of polio. And he spent 2 years bedridden outside of his home where his aunts took care of him. When he came back, he had no strength. I remember him telling me he weighed 97 pounds. Just upon becoming a teenager, he was a burden in a home on a farm in the Depression. And he went out on his own. At 13 years old, he lived in a granary. He took care of himself all the way through high school. He went and worked on a farm in Bloomer, where he went to high school. And the farmer told him, you work for me and I'll pay you when you graduate from school. And his pay was to only be told that chalk it up to experience. He left there, wanted to join the army. But he had polio, and they didn't take people with polio. But he said, you won't take me, but you'll draft me? And they said, that's how it works. Yeah. He said, well, put my name on the top of the draft list then. And they did. And if I'm right, Mom, 3 days later, he was on his way to Fort Chaffee, Arkansas. My dad went to Korea, and the conflict was done, but the shooting wasn't. You know, by signatures and by men in meetings, they were done fighting, but they weren't done fighting. My dad saw combat and was proud to have served. One day he stood in line and they asked if anybody could type, and he raised his hand. He told me, I couldn't type, Brad, but I was going to learn. And he went inside and he became, if you ever watch the television show MASH, my dad was Radar O'Reilly. He kind of even looked like him. And he was 114 pounds, he told me, when he got out of the Army. But he served his time, he flew helicopter weekly to get the mail and paychecks, and he said he was the most popular guy on the post. He was right on the 38th parallel in a place called Incheon. My dad came back, and Bonnie and Glenn Anderson, some wonderful people, took them in Wheeler, and he worked on their farm. And Bonnie introduced them to my mom. It was 2 days after her birthday that he, so in January, the 23rd it would have been, he gave her a ride to work in Rice Lake, correct, Rice Lake? He had a whole car full of people he was giving a ride to, but he left them all behind him, and it just took my mom. They really liked each other because by middle of July, they were married. 63 years. I'm not that old. Debbie's pretty close, but she didn't fall into that 9 month period everybody used to count out back then. But she came a couple of years later. But my dad lived pain. Beyond the polio, heart attack, cutting his fingers off, 5 back surgeries, ruptured Achilles, a tendon. We can go on and on and on the times my dad was hurt. And every time he had never felt any pain worse than that one. They progressively went. He had special sayings that we knew what they meant when we were kids. The one I remember so well is, "These feet walk the hills of Incheon," which means I'm tired. I don't know why he spread it out that way. He could speak some Korean, but nothing I can say here. But I've heard it many, 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 many times. People can tell stories about people and tell you about the time that, remember the time my brother did this, or remember the time my brother did that. My father had an amazing system of sign language that he invented. And my mom and dad sat, I call it Archie Bunker style. They sat side by side in their house, and he watched as after they retired, and especially after his mind was leaving him, he watched his game shows through the day, and Judge Judy, and all these things he enjoyed. My mom learned to hate Family Feud, which was one of his favorites. And then when the evening came, it was baseball, college basketball, or football, whatever was on TV. And no matter how bad his mind got, he could tell you everything that happened. Sharp. He knew the intricacies of sport, and it was kind of neat. But my mom, if you know her, is a very detailed person. And when she told stories of the day, she would sit in her chair where she did her handcrafting, and she would, as you sat, came to visit, you'd sit opposite from them, and she would say, "Today I made lunch, and Ted thought it was okay." There was no sign for the food is good. That didn't exist. My dad liked donuts, cookies, and peanut butter sandwiches. And other than that, he was the most picky man eater you ever have met. So as my mom would say, it was a good meal, and Ted really liked it, you look at him and you get up. That's as best as it got. Normally, it was, "I made a good meal, Ted didn't like it, and you got up." As my mom tried to explain people or things that were going on in the community, my dad's favorite one, and I'll do it now for the rest of my life, was to shake his head, roll his eyes, and move forward. And believe it or not, he could be speaking to you here today, see somebody that drove him to that, and he would do it down here by his hand. It would still, he'd still get the roll. He could be as rude as he could be to anybody. And no one seemed to care. He got away with it. He would have company be ready for him to leave and start talking to my mother and say, "Are they staying? They're right there. Are they staying? Tell them it's going to snow and they need to get out on the road before the roads get bad. In July." He had, these aren't things that happen one time. I tried to decide if I could say thousands, and I know I can say hundreds. But the things that were most important to me is my dad loved my mom beyond explanation. Used to catch him patting her in the butt in the kitchen and holding hands and hours, telling her he loved her. He was quick to anger sometimes, but once you rode out that storm, he was the most gentle thing you could ever meet. And with his love, he told me he loved me every time he spoke to me. He hugged me. He taught me it was okay for a man to cry. He taught me it was not okay for a man to lie. Just say it. Kind of like ripping off a band-aid. Along the way, that advice got me in trouble. But he got away with it. I was lucky. It wasn't perfect, and I wasn't perfect. There were things about me he didn't like. But we got through it together. He judged everybody, yet he didn't judge. It's kind of odd. I don't know how to explain it. It was Ted. I know I'm getting long, but I want you to know those good memories that you have, my dad, we got them every day growing up. If he didn't know the answer, he told you he didn't know. He didn't make it up. He didn't belittle you. Oh yeah, he did. But he could say it in a way that you could walk away okay with. He was a special, special person. And when I look back, I take a look at what I did for a living my whole adult career. I was a probation and parole agent. I met a lot of wonderful people, but I met a lot of people who aren't as wonderful. And I look back at how they grew up in their childhoods and saw how eventually they turned out. He defied all that. It wasn't easy for him. But he made sure that we felt safe, that we felt full. And he loved us. He loved people. I'm going to miss him every day. When I saw him in that pine box, that he was adamant, he was buried in a pine box. I saw him smirking at me. Looked like he could sit up. Looked like he could either tell me how lazy I had been that day or how good of a person he thought I turned out to be. And that's where I end. But thank you.
We'll now hear the old rugged cross. Thank you.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners has been. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my glories at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Our first scripture reading is the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our next reading comes from the 40th chapter of the book of Isaiah, beginning with the 28th verse. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint to grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. This is the word of the Lord. I invite those who are able to please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel comes to the 14th chapter of John, beginning with the first verse. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to Jesus, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. There was no one else on earth like Ted Erickson. No one else on earth like Ted. He was unique and special and extraordinary. Just saying his name, Ted Erickson, brings a smile to my face. He was mischievous and witty, silly, a people person, a talker, a talker, a talker, a talker, a talker, a talker. He just had a way about him that made you love him from the moment you met him. I know I did. From the very first moment I saw that twinkle in his eye, I knew that him and I were really going to get along. But most of all, Ted was steadfast and loyal, faithful, and a servant, starting first and foremost with his family. He loved his family with his whole heart, starting with Carol, his wife of 63 years. Brad stole the story of their first date. But I'd like to add this, which Carol told me after she said this, after she told the story, and I quote, and then I could never get rid of him. And you never did. 6 months after that first date, you were married and you built a true partnership together. That partnership being Carol telling Ted what to do and Ted doing it. But they were true partners in life, supporting each other and being there for each other in the good and the bad. Their love produced their children, Deb, Brad, and Heidi. And Ted was often a stay-at-home dad, doing and folding the laundry while watching Young and the Restless. Not that he would admit he was watching Young and the Restless. Ted was a softie with the kids and wasn't afraid to tell them when they did misbehave, wait till your mother comes home. He was a doting and loving grandfather who was so proud of the accomplishments of his grandchildren and cheered them on all the way in their life. I think there was barely a conversation I ever had with him in which his children or grandchildren did not come up, even at least for a few moments. His love and spirit lives in all of you. Ted was a true servant, the kind of guy that would lend a hand for you whenever you needed it, the kind of guy that would mow 5 or 6 lawns in 95 degree heat, and that included mine. He served his country faithfully in the army, doing a tour of duty in Korea, and he was a clerk in the 1st Cavalry because he could type. He was an educator who served in multiple school districts, and he served his community here in Boyceville on the village board many times. He once got mad at me for a second, in Brad's words, because he came up to me and asked if I would assign his petition to be elected to the village board. And I told him no. He was like, no. I said, Ted, no. I said, I can't. Ethically, as a pastor, I can't sign your petition because there may be other church members you're running against, and it would be wrong for me to do that. But I do promise to vote for you. And that calmed him down a little bit. He used his passion for woodworking to do all sorts of things for people, helping to make repairs and make things for them. I have a few of the things that he made hanging in my office. And you see these over here, the step stools are also from Ted that he made as well. He also, one morning I woke up to find him and Bill Knutson digging a hole in my front yard to put a mailbox in. I didn't ask for a mailbox, I didn't ask for it to be, but there they were at 8 in the morning, putting it in. Ted was always very present at Boyceville Bulldog athletic events, cheering on the Bulldogs. He was a rabid Milwaukee Brewers fan, a huge and massive baseball fan, loved the Badgers, and of course, a loyal Green Bay Packer fan, which is why this Bear fan is currently wearing a Packer stole today. He absolutely loves sports and to talk about them, and we enjoy talking to each other about them. He enjoyed sharing stories and opinions, most especially with the guys shaking dice, coffee every afternoon without fail. And I have no doubt there was an epic reunion in heaven as they gathered for coffee together again. Ted had a sweet tooth, loved cookies and donuts and anything sweet, even swiping extra cookies at supper at Heidi's, even though Heidi had already prepared a to-go bag for him. I would tease him how often he would eat peanut butter sandwiches, especially when Carol would be gone. She would make up all this food for him, instructions on how to heat it up, and she would come home and not a bite of it would have been eaten. Just the peanut butter sandwiches and the sweets. The meal that we have after this service is very much a Ted meal, and when you get in line, you will notice that first are the cookies and the donuts and the bars. Ted had a way of connecting with people, a way to make you laugh. He could say the most outrageous things, and as Brad said, get away with it because of just who he was. Well, he was just Ted. Just Ted. A unique and special child of God. Ted loved his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and he served his Lord and Savior. He loved kids, and he used his talents to be Sunday school superintendent for many years, sharing the love of Jesus Christ with young people. He even chaperoned a few youth trips for the church as well. Ted loved to meet new people, and so he was an incredible asset here at Trinity when he would greet new people when they came in and welcome them. Of course, even before the Alzheimer's, he might not remember them, and greet them a few times and say, it's great for you to meet you for the first time today. And they would say, we've met 6 times, Ted. But he still did it with a smile and he got away with it. You know, Ted always signed up to help at our special meals when we'd have the potato pancake meal or the smelt feed, but he didn't actually work. He sat there with a coffee cup and walked around from table to table telling stories and making people feel good. Because that's what he did. He made people feel good and spread joy in his own special way. I was blessed to be his pastor and was been his pastor from the moment I became one as he was at my ordination. And over the years, he did so many things for me, even taking me to the dentist to get my wisdom teeth taken out, as I had to be put under for that. He was always willing to lead worship when I was gone, and even did so once when I had a family emergency and had to call him up at 6 in the morning and ask him to fill in. He painted the inside of the parsonage house before I arrived, and he reminded me of that often. And he mowed the parsonage yard for years and always took care of our flowers and yard when Amy and I were away on vacation. A few special memories I have of him is the look on his face when I announced I was going to stay here at Trinity after we separated from our Saviors in Wheeler. He was right where the reserved family sign was, and he acted like the Packers had won the Super Bowl. And the reason I looked at him is because he bugged me for 6 days straight about whether I was going to stay at Trinity or not. I cannot help but laugh when I picture him in full football gear, which I put him in as a sermon illustration. It is still one of the funniest things I have ever seen. And he was such a good sport about it. And I remember that when the school was having some budget issues, and they were going to have to cut some teachers, Ted was so concerned, he went to the superintendent of schools to tell them to not let go of my wife. Because if Amy was let go, she might get a job in a different community, and I might leave the church, and we can't have Pastor Brad leaving Trinity. I had to tell him that was incredibly inappropriate, and that he just couldn't do such things. And he just smiled at me with that little smirky smile. We had so many laughs together, and I appreciated every time I saw him. He was an amazing man who I and all of us here are going to miss greatly. Ted was loved by Jesus Christ, who was his way, truth, and life, and has brought him to that heavenly home prepared for him. Jesus forgave him of his sin, gave him strength in the midst of hardship, and lifted him up. Just as it says in Isaiah, those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and not faint. Ted did love a good walk. His walking stick in his hand, a smile on his face, and a chance to have a conversation when he ran into someone. I know we had many outside my house as he walked by. This child of God is now free from pain and suffering, and we will, by the grace of God, see him again someday in that place prepared for all of us. But until that day comes, we will smile at the memories we have of him and remember the love that resides in us all. Ted used to ask me that when his time came, would I do his funeral, no matter where I was? And I told him it would be easy, Ted, because there'd only be three people there. Me, the organist, and the undertaker. Carol and the kids were going on vacation. There's obviously more than three people here today. I hope that as he looks down upon us from heaven, reunited with Aaron, with his friends and family, he sees that there is more than three people here. And I hope that he sees just how much he was loved and will be cherished until the end of time. And so, for the life of Ted Erickson, for the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, we can say thanks be to God. Amen. I invite those who are able to please stand as we sing Amazing Grace, hymn number 779.
Thank you.
I invite you to turn in your bulletin as we confess our shared faith to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. At the end of each prayer petition, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to all who mourn, and assure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. Lord, in your mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death. And by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also. And that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Let us commend Ted to the mercy of God, our Creator and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Ted. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and to the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And now receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.